Lecture number 38, and here we will discuss about descent algorithm, mostly stochastic descent and cost function associated with the linear model of regression and linear model of classification. And how, if you understand descent technique, then I had already mentioned that mostly descent technique here in this course I discuss about only for convex objective function. So here, if you discuss deal with the linear model of for regression, then the corresponding associated objective function happens to be, or cost function happens to be, convex. But if you go to talk about linear model for classification, in that case your that cost function would be non-convex in nature. So in those things, also non-convex things also you can tackle with stochastic gradient descent. Sometimes it may work, so we will see such thing as well. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I will give a recap of last lecture regarding Newton method. Afterward, we will talk about stochastic gradient descent. Afterward, I will discuss that how to formulate cost function for linear model of regression. And if we observe cost of linear model of regression, then it will be convex in nature. And if you, at the first glance, if you try to see the convexity of cost function for linear model of regression, it would be not clear. And it can be established with the help of calculus of convex function that I had already discussed. So that concept is very much essential, that calculus of convex function. Apply that concept here in order to visualize the convexity of cost function. Okay, and if time permits, then we will discuss about cost function of linear model of classification, and there generally we will see that cost function happens to be non-convex in nature, and hence what will happen, simply if you apply gradient descent, it won't work in better way. That means there would be issue with that gradient descent will stuck near local optima. It won't give global optima. So that everyone might be aware of local optima and global optima from math 1. So that criteria is coming when your function happens to be non-convex. So that stuck around local minima. So local minima may or may not be a global minima. So here, coming to first part of the lecture, that regarding Newton method. So in recap, we discussed that Newton method is that here the steepest descent direction we are defining with the help of what we call Poynting norm, where Poynting norm is defined by Hessian of the matrix at that point. So Hessian, it is to measuring the curvature of the point at that point, curvature of the function at that point. So Hessian is very interesting kind of measure, and in order to define quadratic form, we always proceed with one what we call it positive definite matrix. So quadratic norm is defined like this way: a square root of x transpose p x, where p is a positive definite matrix. So generally that means if you are able to find eigenvalue of this matrix, then all eigenvalue would be positive. That is meaning of simple meaning of positive definite. Otherwise there are many other definition of positive definite, where there are many sufficient condition to in order to establish positive definiteness of matrix. So generally Poynting norm of a vector, we denote it by this way, we define it by this way. That means it is associated with some kind of quadratic norm, what we call it, some kind of definite function we have to. But you know that if you here if you try to find Hessian for a convex function, what is happening, that Hessian always happens to be positive semi-definite from what condition? Second order characterization. So if you find Hessian, that means Navier square, it is positive definite, positive semi-definite for a convex, if f is convex. So that criteria is coming, but here equality sign is also coming. So that means Hessian may be zero matrix. In the case when Hessian is zero matrix, then it would be very difficult to define quadratic norm. So for that case, what we do, we are taking very special condition that Hessian must be positive definite. Only in this scenario we try to put it. This scenario we are putting it. So for the function which is having positive definite Hessian, only for that kind of function we can apply Newton method in very interesting way. That Newton method will work very fine for those function which is having positive definite Hessian. Okay, otherwise there would be issue due to this equality vanishing of Hessian. Okay, so algorithm was like this way. Here in gradient descent, we had already seen that this is the update rule or repeated rule iterative process. This is the iterative process in case of gradient descent, where the descent direction it is decided by negative sign of the gradient, negative of the gradient. We are taking descent direction in case of gradient descent. And what is the descent direction in case of what we call it Newton method? We are taking direction it is decided by Hessian inverse of Hessian times gradient. So this is the Newton descent direction. Simply we say that negative, it is talking about descent, negative just we are taking in sense of descent. So this is the Newton descent direction, and that one is coming with respect to Hessian. But one criteria is coming that it must not be, here you are defining inverse, so it must not be what, zero. Hessian should not vanish. It could be not a zero matrix. Zero matrix, big zero I am writing it. It must, that means simply it says that Hessian must be positive definite. And I am not, why I am saying positive definite? Till now, whatever descent technique I discussed, it was only meant for convex function. So convex function, for convex function criteria is that Hessian must be positive semi-definite. That means this condition is the positive semi-definite condition. So here in this Newton method, generally we are putting condition that Hessian happens to be positive semi-definite. If it is zero, there would be issue. There would. So one example, you can see it here like this way. So suppose we are taking a binary classification problem with sample size 500. That means there are 500 data points, and in axis actually there are how many features? 100 number of features are there. So we can compare the gradient descent technique and Newton method for that problem in least in binary classification using logistic regression. So the result is coming like this way. We can see that gradient descent, it is taking time in order to various, it is taking various iteration, means time, simply you can say that various iteration in order to lower down the test accuracy, what you measure, lower down the accuracy. It is taking several, but if you see in Newton method, in one structure it is taking drastically, we see the decrease in the value of the function drastically. That means it is just arriving near to optimal point in one iteration in Newton method. Remember that when we are applying Newton method, when the Hessian happens to be positive definite, if it is not positive definite, then there would be issue. Okay, now this one is the scenario, and also we had already discussed about damped Newton method as well. So one more example I have taken, simplest example, that x1 square plus 5 times x2 square. This, if you, it is a simple quadratic function, and if you want to apply, see the effect of gradient descent. Gradient descent is taking various steps, you can observe here, but Newton method is taking just only one step. Why? This function is very nice. This curvature is very nice. If you try to find the curvature of this one, what it would be given by Hessian, easily you can find Hessian. So first find the gradient of this function. What would be gradient of this function? Anyone? What would be gradient of this function? Tell me anyone, what is the gradient? Gradient would be twice of x1. Second component would be 10 times x2. Now, we try to find Hessian. So what would be Hessian? That is nabla square of f of x. So it is very simple to find. It would be a 2 by 2 matrix. So what would be first component, first entry? Just we have to differentiate this component again. So it would be 2. Now, what would be here? 0, 0, 10. Okay, tell me what are the eigenvalue of this Hessian matrix? Anyone? Very simple question I am asking. Naveen, what are the eigenvalue of this Hessian matrix? Don't know. Yeah, this is the matrix, this Hessian matrix. What are the eigenvalue? What? Yeah, nice. It is a diagonal, so easily you can visualize. So tell me, what would be definiteness of, what is the definite of this matrix, whether it is positive definite or negative definite? Hmm? or positive semi-definite. Comment over this. It is just a part of your linear algebra course that you had already gone through. Here I told that if eigenvalues happens to be all eigenvalues happen to be positive, then easily that matrix would be positive definite. So here we see that both the eigenvalue are positive. First eigenvalue is 2, second eigenvalue is 10. So we can say that the corresponding Hessian matrix, it happens to be positive definite matrix. It is positive definite. So that's why Newton method is working fine for this one. But if you are getting a function whose Hessian happens to be positive semi-definite, that means at some point the Hessian is vanishing. Hessian is vanishing. In that case, you will face problem in applying Newton method. You will face problem. So that scenario I want to highlight it. So I will talk about further that next first order technique, stochastic gradient descent. So it is especially for a classification kind of problem. This means for especially classification kind of problem. And here you don't need to calculate Hessian, just you can proceed with gradient. Even gradient of one component associated with that Hessian function, that cost function would be enough. So here objective function generally in case of gradient descent happens to be summation of various component. Like suppose in there is n sample, a sample of s size n, that means n number of component are there. So with respect to each component, you would like to define a cost function f of ix. It is talking about cost function. So what you do in order to discuss the complete data set that given to you, a complete sample given to you, so what you have to do, you have to take representation or representative cost function. So fi of x, it is talking about cost function of a single ith, what we call it ith element. It is talking about ith sample point. It is ith sample point. So if you are willing to find a representation of the cost function, what you take best representation is given by average. Average out the those costs, that will be your representation cost for the training data. The data what is given to you. Okay, so that's where we are taking average of all those cost function. So that's where it is a very specific kind of objective function. And here again, we are not putting any constant, we are just minimizing this function. So this simply you can denote it, this one is your f of x, very special kind of things. Okay, we are again doing unconstant minimization, we are not putting any constant over here. So here further we put condition that it individual f of i happens to be convex in nature, convex and differentiable. Each fi happens to be convex and differentiable. So if you define f, it happens to be what, summation of all these. So easily we can say that corresponding function f would be also convex and differentiable. Why? Because it is coming from the calculus of convex function. Okay, from calculus of convex function you can easily establish that sum of convex function would be again a convex. So it is talking about summation, and 1 by n is just a what? It is a natural number, counting, it is a factor, one kind of constant factor with respect to x. So we can say that sum of these cost functions, individual cost function, happens to be again a convex function, provided the individual cost function are convex. If it is convex and differentiable, same criteria and differentiable. First order derivative, you can talk about existence of first order derivative just for the calculation of gradient, because we are just going to apply what we call it stochastic gradient descent. Okay, so here how you can find gradient, you can find gradient of this function f by finding the gradient of component function and summing it up. And 1 by n is silent here, 1 by n it would be what, constant with respect to gradient, so we don't need to worry about 1 by x. So here if you are willing to find gradient of this function f, simply find the gradient of individual component and sum it up, you will get that. So that means the gradient is what, interchangeable with sine due to these two property, convexity and differentiability. This differentiability, generally due to this differentiability property, this gradient is interchangeable with summation sign. So that's where you are getting this scenario. So this way you can calculate gradient. Now coming to that, if you talk about gradient descent technique for this kind of objective function, so what would be gradient descent? That we have to completely proceed with this. That means we have to take gradient of each component. Here you can observe that here gradient of each component is involved in case of gradient descent. That means there are n number of gradient we need to calculate. If sample size is n, we need to calculate n number of gradient, and then we have to average it out by dividing by n. Okay, so n number of computation we are doing in case of gradient descent. If suppose n is very large, in that case like 1000, 10,000, million, billion, like kind of things, then that time this calculation would be very tedious, very complicated kind of calculus. But if you see in gradient, stochastic gradient descent, what we do? We are not proceeding with a calculation of gradient of each component, each sample point. What we do in place of that, we just try to do one sampling, that we try to select any one or few sample point, for that we can proceed with gradient of that. So here you can observe that. So ith simply I would like to say. So at the kth iteration, ith sample has been selected. K is talking about we are at current iteration is the kth iteration. At the kth iteration, among the n number of sample point, we have selected any one, ith one we have selected. Ith one we have selected, and we are just trying to get a search direction with respect to gradient of the ith component, direction of the ith component. Okay, so see, simply you can say that here you perform n number of gradient computation, but here just you need to perform only one gradient computation. So that's where this method is very interesting. And if you talk about, definitely one question will come to you, whether this algorithm is going to converge to optimal point. Definitely it will converge. And there is a theory behind that, and it is directly coming from that expectation that we need to. So that we will see that here, this, if you are taking this is what, simply you can say that it is a sample gradient. Sample gradient, you can say that, and then sample gradient or one estimator, or some better call it sample in place of sample gradient, it is one estimate of the gradient, actual gradient. So one estimate, it is an estimate of the gradient. So it would be a very good estimator if in large sample theory, that means if you take expectation of this one, and if expectation of this one is leading towards the actual gradient, then in that case we can say that it is a unbiased estimator. Suppose if it is an unbiased estimator, so then in that case it will, this stochastic gradient descent will work very fine. So we are calling it is one estimate of total gradient of the function f of x, one estimate. So we here in a stochastic gradient, we just proceed with one estimate of the actual gradient of the function, and we try to proceed in that direction. The direction is decided by one estimate of the gradient. So that estimate is coming from ith sample point, the gradient of ith sample point. Okay, so what are the approaches of performing that sampling, the sampling of gradient? That means how you can select that estimate of a gradient. So there are actually generally two way. At kth iteration, you can choose the index I in two way. That means there are two. One approach is, we are calling it randomized rule approach. So here in the randomized rule, what we do, among the n number of sample points, we are selecting any one at random. Then anyone may recall what would be probability distribution of this uniformly random selection. That probability distribution, that means density, probability mass function here, discrete points are here, it would be 1 by n, because we do perform uniform selection. So it would be here the ith component, what ith sample point what we are choosing, that happens to be uniformly distributed, uniform distribution, and that corresponding probability mass function would be 1 by n, because there are n number of points. So with respect with probability 1 by n, we are selecting ith component, ith sample point. Okay, and if you talk about further, there is one more technique. This one is first randomized, another one is cycling. That means we can take the ith component from first end, or we keep on repeating like this with cycle. It is coming like this way. So this cyclic approach. But if you talk about better approach of indexing that component, what we are selecting or what we estimate, this is the best better approach. Why? There is a reason. There is a reason is that here, if you see that corresponding what we call it. Estimate of the gradient. You can say that it is one estimate of the gradient. The estimate that means as a gradient of ith component. This estimate we are getting as a gradient of ith component. It is an unbiased estimate of the unbiased estimate of the gradient of function, objective function. It is unbiased estimate. So why? We can see that if you try to find expectation of this one, it is a very simple kind of derivation. You can easily establish that if you're finding the expectation of ith component of the gradient, then due to that uniform probability 1 by m, the expectation would be equal to gradient of function at the kth iteration. So that's where we can say that simply this, if you proceed with this as an estimate of gradient of the function, then it is unbiased. Why? Because expectation of this one is equal to value of the gradient of the function. So that's where randomized approach is very much common in practice. So here main appeal of gradient descent. Why? Here what are the features of gradient descent? We can see that. So here iteration cost is independent of n. Here we don't have to perform n number of computation of gradient. Just we have to perform computation of only one gradient of only gradient of only one simple point. So that's why it is independent of n. Okay. Second, it can be also a big saving in term of memory usage. We know that if you are willing to calculate gradient of the actual given function, objective function, then here there are n number of components. So definitely it will take more memory relative than this one. This one will take very less memory. See, because it is talking about only one estimate, so it will take very less memory. It is talking about only one sample code, so that's way. So from the memory point of view, this stochastic gradient descent is more appealing. So here I would like to take one example that one is directly coming from logistic regression. So in logistic regression, for that means for but actually problem is that we have to do binary classification. That means we are having data features xi's, and we have to say that whether xi belongs to zero class or one class. Yi is taking two value, either zero or one. So yi is talking about label or class label simply. So either those xi data will fall in zero class or in one class, and we are having n number of sample. Okay, so simple question would be that what is the cost function for performing this logistic regression? That means how we can get optimal linear model for classification. So here I told that we are dealing with logistic regression. So what would be our hypothesis function? That hypothesis function it says that our probability it would be function of what we call it a parameter. So I am writing here parameter omega, which generally denoted by omega. So it is logistic function. Logistic happens to be inverse of logit. That means 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus derived variable omega transpose x plus bias also you can take it. You can take it bias. This is the further if you want to simplify, then it will take a ratio kind of form e to the power omega transpose x plus b. If you simplify, then you will get this structure 1 plus e to the power omega transpose. This is the logistic function, that hypothesis function, what we take in case of logistic regression. Okay, and we do thresholding in order to perform binary classification. So main question is coming that here, what is the what we call it here cost function. So cost function we can simply define it with the help of likelihood approach. Likelihood approach we can define cost function, and here bias is taken as zero. Bias is zero. We have taken it zero. This is the cost function. So you can observe that here with respect to each sample point we are having a term. So that's why there are n number of cost component, and we are summing up, we are getting total cost. This is the total cost after we do divide by And then we are getting this is simply we can say the average cost for logistic performing logistic regression with n number of sample points, n number of sample, that sample of size n. So that's where we are getting this kind of function. It is very much matches with the objective function of gradient stochastic gradient descent technique. Okay, so if you are willing to find gradient of this function, it looks very easy to find gradient. Despite of all these logarithmic terms, if you try to find derivative of this one or gradient of this one, the gradient is taken like this way. So there are n number of component you can observe that. So best way that just proceed with one estimate of this gradient, one estimate of this gradient, and you will get your very good convergence of your problem. So here a few more example I have taken. So I am taking again similar to last case that one I had discussed about by this classification. Suppose you are taking in 10 number of sample points. That means a sample of size 10 in two dimensional. That feature space is two dimensional. That means either height or weight, something like this. That situation is coming. So for that we can perform batch gradient or stochastic gradient. What is meaning of batch gradient? It says that when you are dealing with all the component, and then the corresponding gradient is having a special name. We are calling it batch gradient. If you are dealing with all the sample point, then that gradient, simply if you are applying gradient descent, that would be your batch gradient. And if you are just dealing with one sample point, then it would be a stochastic gradient. So that is the difference between batch gradient and a stochastic gradient. So for this problem, we can see that gradient descent, definitely it would be very fast. It would be of order p, and gradient or simply gradient descent, it would be order n time p because there are n number of sample points. So that's why here you can say that this one is slower than this stochastic gradient. Stochastic gradient is relatively faster, right? Because it is dealing with at a time at kth iteration, it is just dealing with only one sample point. That's why stochastic gradient is very faster. And rule of thumb also we can apply it here like this way. Generally, from what we do, generally it's sluggish to optimum, what we call it. And we can see in pictorial way. It is that simply I would like to say that the path of the gradient descent, it happens to be random, zigzag kind of a structure. So this is the red one is the path of gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, and blue one is the path of batch gradient descent or simply gradient descent you can call it. Gradient descent, I told that at the training time, if you are proceeding with all these sample point, that n number of sample point, that would be batch gradient. Simply it is asking what is the batch size, then it is, your answer will be how many sample point you are taking the training data. So if you are taking n number of sample point, the n would be your batch size. So that means you are taking all the data. So that's where this blue is coming with respect to batch gradient, and random is coming with respect to that single selection of the sample point, gradient of sample point, single selection. So that's where it is zigzag, but definitely it is going to converge to this point very fast. This rate you can see that because you are just proceeding with only one component of the gradient. So that's why it is relatively faster than batch gradient or simply gradient descent. It is, so that you can see it like this. Now here, next I will talk about cost function for various Lipnov function. Sorry, cost function for various linear model for regression, and we will talk about convexity of those cost function. How we can talk about convexity of those cost function? So simplest one here, generally if you are in learning problem, what do you do? Any question? No. Okay, fine. So I will go forward. So in learning problem, what you do? You always come up with one hypothesis function, and the hypothesis function we for simplest case we try to parameterize it, and we try to estimate the parameter. Actually, our intention is we need to estimate the hypothesis function. But if you go through general form of hypothesis function, it would be very tough task to estimate the function. So we do parameterize that hypothesis function, and the parametric form is coming with respect to some parameter omega. And how we do estimate? We introduce some kind of criterion function or loss function, that L. Generally, simplest loss function happens to be quartic loss. So we can proceed with quartic loss, and we can see that in large sample, definitely if you are proceeding with just few samples. So definitely we don't know the distribution of the corresponding estimator. So if you talk about in large sample size, then it will converge to actual expectation. This one is what empirical estimate, what we go through that is whatever sample provided to us, and we are applying uniform random selection. Through that we come up with one empirical. This one is empirical estimate of the expectation. Okay, and this one is the true estimate of the expectation. So definitely in large term, the empirical estimate, it will converge to true estimate. Okay, so here coming to linear regression. So here I will take a multiple linear regression. That means there is a univariate linear model for linear regression where there are many features. There are many features, or there are many what we call it regressor. So x1, x2, up to xn, n number of regressor we observe it here. And this one is the explicit form, and we can write this linear model in a very compact form using dot product of this x and omega. Omega happens to be our parameter that we want to estimate, and error term is also coming. Okay, here x I am talking about, this is the x vector having n plus 1 component. X naught is coming with respect to omega naught, that bias term is there. With respect to bias term, x naught is coming. And what is the value of x naught? X naught value of x naught equal to 1. Just for systematic representation, we are putting all these things. And omega is again n plus 1 dimensional vector, where first omega naught it is coming with respect to bias, and others are coming with respect to as a coefficient of corresponding features. What we call it. So this one is simply a linear model. Simply you can say that it is linear regression. What we do, linear regression with multiple regressor or multiple features, what we call it. Now for this linear regression, how we can define cost function? So cost function, we can define that with respect to each sample, we have to find a cost function, which xi, I type, suppose I equal to 1 to n. Or better, I would like to change notation. N, we have taken number of features. So if you sample size take M, okay, suppose you are taking M number of samples, 1, 2, 3, it will go up to M number of sample you have taken. That means N number of these linear equations you will get, N number of folks. So for with respect to ith sample, this one is coming, this quadratic loss with respect to ith sample. Okay, we are taking this one is quadratic loss. The difference between this value of hypothetical function at ith sample xi and this yi, this one given value of y. Okay, so this one is, this loss is with respect to ith sample. We have to sum it up and average out. So in order to get a representation of the cost function for sample, that data set of with m number of component. Okay, so what is this one? Further we try to express this one like this way. So if you are trying to express like this way, and in quadratic loss, how we define a square of quadratic norm? This one is, it is talking about x transpose x. So if it is function of one variable, then what does it become? It becomes just x square. So it is a quadratic function. That's where this term I have taken it. This notation I have taken it. So further, if you simplify, you are trying to give a compact notation of this cost function. Then compact notation, it is taking like data matrix times omega minus y. Here this y is different from yi. What is this y? This y is the response vector. That means you had m number of sample point, sample size was m, so that's where we are having m observation of y. So if you take all those observation of y in together, then you will get a response vector. This you can say that it is, this y is a response vector. It is a response, this y, it is a response vector. Y is a response variable, and if you take all the observation y in together in a vector form, then it becomes a response vector. So this representation I had already discussed during that linear model class for regression. We had already discussed. So this is cost function. So by default, simply if I ask, tell me what is the convexity of this cost function? Anyone would recall what is the convexity of this cost function? Whether it, this cost function is convex or non-convex? from calculus of convex. Can you recall it? If you try to see this function here, this just focus on this argument. What does it talk about? You can write it this one as t square, where what is t? T is actually linear function of omega xi transpose omega minus yi, linear function. So we know that t square is a, if you try to see t square, it is a square function having positive curvature. That means it is what? This function is always a convex function, t square. This one is t square. If you try to plot it like this way, this one is t square along vertical axis, t is along horizontal axis. So this one is a what? It is a convex function. Due to that, we can say that t square is a convex function. Now, we know that if you, what you do, if you change the argument of the function, in a linear fashion, if you change in linear fashion, then what will happen? The with respect to that linear affine transformation of argument, convexity is not going to change. Again, that would be convex. So we know that here t square is a convex function of omega. Simply t of omega, you can write it. You can write it like this way. It is t square. It is convex function. If we change the argument, with affine way, then what will happen? So this is affine function or linear function of omega. So due to that, that a square of this one would be again a convex function. That means simply I would like to say that omega, if you are taking omega as square, it is a convex function, and if you replace by affine function of omega, again it would be a convex function due to that properties. Okay, and hence we can say that this objective function would be always a convex function. So here in case of cost function for regression model, we are getting a convex function. Now we can talk about one example here. So example is coming like this way. You can see it here. So here we are performing linear regression with features x1 and x2. Two features we are having. So we can put in systematic the compact form. This is the compact form. So here, if you define cost function, this is the cost function. This is the cost function, which is quadratic in nature, and hence it is a convex function. So easily you can apply your whatever technique we discussed till now here in optimization algorithm. You can apply any of those and you will get optimal value. This is the optimal value. This is the optimal value what you will get from gradient. You are free to apply gradient descent. You are free to apply Newton method. You are free to apply stochastic gradient descent. You are free to apply any other technique what we discuss here. So you can apply, and in all those techniques, definitely you will get value very, very near to this optimal. This is the optimal value, very near to optimal value. Okay. Other thing we will discuss in a next class. If anyone is having any question,